How are you guys holding up to the pandemic?
Can you hear me, Judge?
I can hear you. I think it's a filter.
It is, and I don't know how to remove it. I've got my assistant here. She's trying to, but I'm here live. I'm not a cat.
I can see that.
Welcome back to PhD Coffee Time. This is the online community for you as PhD student to get motivation, peer support, and practical tips during your PhD. Today's coffee break, I want to bring your attention to your self-care because we have been at home and a lot of time it feels like we are almost trapped in this tiny box of virtual conversation. And it does have a big implication to our daily health and our attention span. And this is called
Zoom fatigue.
Zoom fatigue.
Zoom fatigue.
It's a pleasure for me to interview the researcher that is working on Zoom fatigue.
As the member of our research team, we're talking about how exhausted they felt participating in so many video conferences during, you know, COVID. And we started to hear the term of Zoom fatigue in the media, and it became some kind of a buzzword. So my name is Géraldine Fauville. I'm an assistant professor at the Department of Education, Communication and Learning at the University of Gothenburg in Sweden. I'm the lead researcher on what we call the ZEF scale, Zoom Exhaustion and Fatigue Scale. So this research is a collaboration between two labs in the Department of Communication at Stanford University. The Virtual Human Interaction Lab, founded by Professor Bellinson, and the Social Media Lab, founded by Professor Hancock. And we started working on the ZEF scale in May 2020. We ran 5 studies with more than 3,000 participants. And now we have the ZEF scale, which includes 15 questions about how you feel after video conferencing. And altogether, these items measure your ZEF score, so to what extent you're suffering from Zoom fatigue. And these 15 items or these 15 questions accounts for 5 different types of fatigue: general, visual, emotional, social, and motivational. So if you go on the link provided, you can actually take this ZEF scale and you get some feedback about your own level of Zoom fatigue. And based on that, you can think about your behavior during these video conferences and adapt it in order for you maybe to suffer a bit less from Zoom fatigue. With this first study, we showed that the more video conference call people participate in, or the longer these calls are, the more Zoom fatigue people will experience. The more Zoom fatigue you experience, the more negative attitude you will have toward video conference. First of all, what we call Zoom fatigue is a feeling of exhaustion that's associated with using any video conference platform. So it's not something that is specific to the Zoom platform. So there are 4 suspected causes of Zoom fatigue. So the first one is that you have large faces staring at you. During an in-person meeting, people will stare at you when you are speaking. And previous research has shown that social anxiety of public speaking is very common. But when someone else takes over, you're not the center of the attention anymore. So during a video conference, regardless if you're speaking or not, it seems like all the eyes are on you all the time. So it feels like you're constantly in a stressful position, which can be very intense. So that's one aspect, is that all the eyes are on you. The second aspect of this potential cause of Zoom fatigue, depending on the computer screen, you have very big faces in front of you. And this large size of the faces is the real world equivalent of someone standing uncomfortably close to you, like if someone was invading your personal space. And this kind of physical proximity between two people is perceived by the brain as a situation that would lead either to mating or to fighting. So it's a very intense situation for the brain. What we recommend is to decrease the size of your video conference window, but also having an external keyboard so you increase the distance between you and the camera. For me, you are a very small window on the side. The second potential cause of Zoom fatigue is this constant mirror in front of you. So when you are in a video conference and your camera is on, you see the image from your own camera. So it's like having a mirror in front of yourself all the time. Just imagine like spending a day of your life with your assistant following you around, holding a mirror. And every time you interact with someone, that person like pops the mirror in front of your face. That would be very unsettling. And research has shown that seeing your own image leads to self-evaluation, which can lead to negative affects such as bad mood and anxiety. This self-image and self-evaluation leading to negative impact is especially strong among women, actually. Kind of an easy tip with this one is to disable the cell view that you can do on Zoom. You cannot do it on every video conference platform. Just hide your cell view. So your camera is still on, people still see you, but you don't need to see yourself. The third cause of Zoom fatigue is less mobility. So during in-person meeting or phone calls, people have the option to move around. For example, in face-to-face meeting, you can stretch, you can get up to write on the whiteboard, you can go get a drink. So there is, you know, this motion as part of the meeting. During a phone call, you can actually be engaged in other tasks like watering your plant or walking around your house while you still fully engage with the phone call. Researchers have shown that motion is important for learning, for creativity, and for brain performance. The problem is during video conference, when your video is on, there is this expectation that you will stay in the camera view, kind of facing the screen, which decreases the range of motion you can engage in during these calls. In some way, you feel like you're trapped in the view of the camera. So the recommendation here is using, for example, a standing desk. So at least you can stretch your legs and, you know, move around a bit more than if you were like sitting. Yeah. But also having, as I already mentioned earlier, having an external keyboard. Mm-hmm. So you like further away from the camera and you have a bit more of space to move in the view of the camera. The tip that has had the most impact for me is being able to actually be standing and feel active when I'm on a Zoom call. And sometimes I have meetings with students and they're sitting and they have their laptop on their laps. Like they're really stuck, they really cannot move. So I'm trying also to talk with them about like working station, because it's not just one day that we are at home, it's for a long period of time. So it's very important to think about, you know, your physical wellness as well as mental wellness, actually.
How should this conversation begin?
I think our research on Zoom fatigue is a very good way to start having a conversation about the fact that this is real. This is something people are suffering from. Adjusting some of the meeting culture, you can actually improve everyone's health. Don't ask everyone to have their camera all the time if it's not needed. Learn how to deal with Zoom fatigue and how to be more understanding of people suffering from it and needing some adaptation.
I personally find it more productive sometimes when we just have a share screen meeting.
Yeah.
When people, you know, share the screen, and that by default, after you share screen, all the videos channels are minimized on the corner. So
yeah,
people are focusing on the task instead of focusing on how we look that day and what we wear that day. We forget to listen when there is visual cues.
Right. And that brings us actually to the last cause of Zoom fatigue, which is this difficulty with nonverbal communication. So when you're interacting in person, most people have this instinctive understanding of nonverbal behavior, such as the intonation and the orientation of your body, for example. And these are very important cues in conversation. It helps us understand when you feel like you can interrupt someone who's speaking without being rude, or it helps us show interest or lack of interest in when someone is speaking. During video conference, you only see the head and the shoulder of the other participants. So a lot of the nonverbal communication is lost. So first, in order to understand what the other participants mean behind their words, you will need to like consciously monitor the nonverbal behavior much more actively than you would do in a face-to-face situation. And on the other hand, in order for you to communicate this kind of cues to the other participant, you will intensify the cues, for example, by nodding more vigorously, than you would do if you were in the same room. Some researchers have shown that video conference is more taxing for the brain than audio-only conversation, when you don't need at all to worry about the body language that is not present. So you can focus only on what you can get, which is the audio. You know, the recommendation is, as we already talked about, turn your camera off when it's not needed. And don't feel offended and don't question someone who decides to turn their camera off.
If you are a professor watching this video and you're asking Zoom meeting from your PhD student, I hope this video inspires you to rethink whether it is necessary to turn on camera channel and whether everyone needs to show up.
And I think you can even go a step further, asking yourself, do we really need to have this conversation on video conference? Can it be an email? Can it be a phone call, where you don't have the burden of the video at all, or the expectation to be on camera, or to have to justify yourself?
So Geraldine, we are coming to the end of this conversation. Thank you so much for watching today, and I'll see you the next time.
Thank you so much for having me.
If you're learning something today, please make sure to hit the like button so that it really will help me reach more PhD students out there. Comment below if you have any feedback about this video, and I will send her all your comments. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you the next time.